Hello, my name is Jim Keller. I'm a professor of pharmacy medicine and oncology out of the University of Texas at Austin and the Health Science Center in San Antonio. We're going to talk today about the incidence and risk factors involved with chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting, also referred to as CINV. So let's talk about the predictability and preventability of chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. First of all, you must understand that CINV is a common, predictable, and from a patient standpoint, feared side effect of chemotherapy. CINV is often preventable with appropriate prophylactic treatment. Also, CINV can negatively affect patients' overall experience. We know for sure that the preventive measures should be used in that very first cycle of chemotherapy. The best way to keep patients from getting sick is to keep them from getting sick in the very first time they receive chemotherapy. Also, the prevalence of anticipatory nausea and vomiting, which we will talk about, may be lower today with better antiemetic therapies. If we can treat the first cycle of therapy more effectively, patients having anticipatory effects in subsequent cycles will just be reduced. So this is a slide that shows you the patient's experience in their rank of severe CINV as it relates to other problems that cancer patients can have. If you look at the top to the left, a patient with complete control actually feels very good. They feel in perfect health. They feel like a normal being. But when you look down on the right end of this curve, you can see that for patients with poorly controlled, both acute and delayed nausea and vomiting due to chemotherapy, that's just a step above death. And for many people, if you've ever experienced protracted nausea and vomiting, and at times you say, man, I'd just as soon shoot myself than have this protracted nausea and vomiting, you can imagine how patients are when we induce this in them with chemotherapy. So along with other side effects and toxicities that cancer patients can have, poorly controlled nausea and vomiting is one of the most dreaded side effects that patients go through as part of their chemotherapy. When you talk about chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting, we really have to classify the different types of nausea and vomiting. In this slide, we can see these, and we're going to go through the classification, the definitions. Acute nausea and vomiting is typically referred to that which occurs in the first 24 hours after the chemotherapy is administered. Delayed nausea and vomiting is that time frame after the first 24 hours, so it's going to be days 2 through 5, 6, 7, so it's anything past that first day that patients can have. Breakthrough nausea and vomiting is that occurs despite the appropriate prophylactic therapy. So patients who receive antiemetic therapy and still throw up after they receive the chemotherapy, that would be considered breakthrough. Anticipatory is that is conditioned response. So patients that come into a clinic, they have the sights and sounds and smells, and they associate those sights and sounds and smells with the vomiting that they get when they come to clinic. Then the next time, if they have that nausea and vomiting, as they come in the next time and they experience those same sights, sounds, and smells, they can throw up just from that before they even get the chemotherapy. So that's what we call anticipatory. And finally is refractory. Refractory is that occurs in subsequent cycles after patients have been treated and try to go for prophylaxis and give the appropriate drugs, and they continue to break through and have nausea and vomiting irrespective of the agents we give to try and stop it. So those are the definitions, and we'll be using those throughout the presentation. So let's talk about the incidence and impact of CINV. Overall, it varies by the emetogenic potential of the specific chemotherapy agents the patient's getting, and also some patient-specific related factors. So the CINV primarily is related to the emetogenic potential of the chemotherapy. For agents that can induce nausea and vomiting in greater than 90% of patients who receive that drug, that is considered to be called highly emetogenic chemotherapy, or for short, we call it HEC, H-E-C. For patients who have nausea and vomiting induced either between 30 and 90% of the time when they receive an agent, that's called MEC, moderately emetogenic chemotherapy. So the two primary categories of emetogenic chemotherapy are MEC and HEC, moderate and high. Moderate is 30 to 90% chance of having emesis. High is over 90% chance of having emesis. CINV during the delayed phase can actually be more problematic than the acute phase. So the incidence of delayed chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting when the patient's out of the clinical and the patient's home on their own is many times and has many times been underestimated. As we talked about earlier, that anticipatory nausea and vomiting appears to occur in up to 30% of patients. So again, patients can have these effects when they come in and see a clinic, or they see a specific nurse, or they see, or they smell, or they taste a specific taste, can have anticipatory nausea and vomiting. The anticipatory vomiting can occur in up to 10% of patients. And again, a lot of times this anticipatory nausea and vomiting is hard to manage, so it's hard to treat, and a lot of times patients will just have that. Go to the next slide, and I want to talk about those patient factors. Besides the emetogenic potential of the chemotherapy, there are patient factors that make them more at risk for this CINV. One is female. Females have a higher chance of having emesis than males. Younger adults, adults less than 50 years of age. Individuals who have low alcohol intake, less than an ounce and a half a day, have a higher chance. If you have a history of motion sickness, and people, again, who get car sick while they're driving, or if they're on a ship, or if they're in an airplane, they have a higher risk. And again, for women who have had a history of morning sickness during their pregnancy, have a higher risk. And certainly for patients that have had prior chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting from previous treatment, would be at a higher risk for subsequent chemotherapy they are going to receive. So to summarize this part, let's talk about the uncontrolled nausea and vomiting that are still highly feared side effects of chemotherapy. Also, prevention is still the best course of action for managing chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. Controlling CINV on that first cycle is very important. It's the best predictor. The emetogenicity of these chemotherapy agents are important. The ones that we deal with most often in practice are the MEC, modern emetogenic agents, and HEC, the highly emetogenic agents. Other patient factors also come into play. We mentioned age, gender, patients having motion sickness, women having prior morning sickness, limited alcohol intake, and just previous CINV from previous therapy can also increase the risk of CINV. That is the end of this session. I want to thank you for joining us.